Hi, everyone. I am Jennifer Hancock, and this is the program Teaching Teachers to Teach Values from the International Humanistic Management Association. Our guest today is Mary Gentile. She is the creator and director of Giving Voice to Values. She's a professor of practice at the University of Virginia Darden School of Business, a senior advisor to the Aspen Institute Business and Society Program, and consultant on management education and leadership development. Welcome, Mary. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you. Pleasure Perfect. To be here.
Great. So if you can spend about 15 minutes talking to us about how you teach values, and then we can open it up for questions. And for everyone, if you have a question, please ask it in the chat.
Great. Thank you, Jennifer. And thanks for the opportunity to share with you all today. I see a few people I know in the participant list, so hello. Anyways, so I'm going to talk to you a bit about Giving Voice to Values, or GVV as I refer to it. Giving Voice to Values grew out of my experience trying to create and teach and work with values-driven leadership and business ethics in MBA programs. I was part of the team that designed the first required ethics curriculum at Harvard Business School, and I taught in that. And I've also worked with other business schools around the world on these issues. And frankly, I got kind of discouraged with the way we taught about them. And so Giving Voice to Values is a different kind of approach. We developed it about, I guess now about 10 or 12 years ago. And it's now currently being used, it's been used literally all over the world on all seven continents. It's originally was designed for business schools exclusively, but it's now being used in businesses and in NGOs. And in, we work with the US military, Australian police force, et cetera, et cetera. But if you don't remember anything else from what I'm about to tell you about, this is the heart of Giving Voice to Values. Giving Voice to Values is about asking and answering a different question when it comes to values and ethics in business. So instead of the typical question that we ask, which is what is the right thing to do in any particular situation, that's a good question. It's an important question. It's one that you probably, if you teach these issues, you probably spend some time on it. But that's usually where we stopped. And Giving Voice to Values is about asking and answering the question, once you know what you believe the right thing to do is, how could you get it done effectively, successfully? This kind of grew out of my frustration that the way we tended to approach these issues as if they were entirely a cognitive problem. If we just had this black box decision-making framework, you could put all the data in and then the right and ethical answer would come out the other side and then we would be done. And I was really frustrated with that because of course there are issues that are very complex and it's not clear what the right thing to do is. But it seemed that many of the cases that sort of drew our attention and concern to ethics in business were often cases where the offenses were more egregious and a little more clear, and that there were often many people who felt uncomfortable at a minimum, but actually just didn't think they had any options, didn't think they had choices. And so that was kind of the trigger for me. First, I was just frustrated with that. And then, you know, around that time, as I say, about 10 or 12 years ago, I started to see a lot of research in a number of different disciplines that was suggesting that if you really want to approach these issues and actually have an impact on behavior, that an effective strategy is rehearsal and pre-scripting and peer coaching. So in the field of psychology, you've probably seen some of the research on habit formation, for example, or looking at the folks who do research on what they call positive deviance, you know, people who deviate from the norm, but in a positive direction. They have a great phrase for talking about this. They say, if you want to have an impact on people's behavior, rather than asking them to think their way into a different way of acting, it's more impactful to ask them to act their way into a different way of thinking. And then there was, you know, a lot of the behavioral ethics and research also, you know, triggered some new thoughts about this. And then, you know, there's been such a popularization of research in cognitive neurosciences, and you've probably seen, you know, research around brain plasticity or creating new neural pathways. Antonio Damasio has done some of this work. I always like to talk about research from the field of kinesthetics, or the study of physical movement. which grew out of my experience taking a self-defense class years ago. And they would, you know, they would teach you all the physical moves, you know, fist to bridge of nose and heel to instep. They'd have you practice them, but then they would bring in a gentleman in a padded suit, like the Michelin Man, and you would, he would attack us full force, and then you could use your moves on him full force. And they explained to us, and those of you who are athletes will be familiar with this, they explained to us that the idea that this process, it was a developmental model, but it was this training process was based on the idea of specific state muscle memory. So the idea was if you rehearse something in the physiological and cognitive and emotional state that you'll be in when you need to use it, that even if you freeze in that moment of stress, your body remembers. And so this kind of triggered an idea for me. I was thinking, well, could you create a kind of moral muscle memory? Could you create a default behavior, a default to voice, but not just to speaking up, but rather a default to informed voice? Because I was gathering many, many stories from both MBA students who'd worked in business for a few years, as well as from middle managers and senior executives all the way up to the C-suite. And I was gathering stories about times when they had tried to act on values conflicts. And I was realizing that very often the people who did this successfully, it wasn't a matter of whistleblowing or calling out their boss and saying he or she was evil or, you know, any of that. It was much more nuanced. It was much more sophisticated. It was much more tactical. They were, in fact, using the language and the vocabulary and the analytics decision-making frameworks of whatever discipline or functional area they worked in to make their case. So I was realizing that often when people look at an ethical issue, it's as if they dumb themselves down. You know, everything that you're already teaching them in all the other courses around negotiations, around problem reframing, around power and influence, and also, you know, around analytics in accounting or in finance or how to think about, you know, reaching out to new market segments or supply chain sort of challenges, that we, it was as if we would throw all that out the window and we would, you know, feel like we had to make this impassioned moral complaint, which was often not that effective and could be quite detrimental to the person who raised it. And so what I wanted to do was to look at ways that people did this effectively and to actually give people the opportunity to create action plans and scripts, and then to peer coach with those, to practice them and peer coach to enhance them. So it was kind of the idea behind GVV. Instead of focusing primarily on building awareness of ethical issues by sharing cases and building tools for analysis by either teaching the relevant laws and regulations or philosophy, you know, deontology, utilitarianism, et cetera. Those are important things, but then to go to the next step. So build awareness, teach analysis, now teach action. And so that was the core idea. We had to develop a different teaching technology to do that. So we created what we call the Giving Voice to Values Thought Experiment. I used to run the case writing program at Harvard Business School, so I was very familiar with that methodology, but we tweaked it. So our cases tend to be much shorter. Sometimes there are a few pages, sometimes there are even just a few paragraphs. They feature people at every level in the organization, not just the CEO as a traditional, you know, case study, because people, I was, you know, working with MBAs and business, even undergraduates sometimes, who were experiencing issues right away. So we have people at every level because the challenges can be different. But the big difference is they're what one dean called post-decision-making cases. So they end with a protagonist who already knows what he or she thinks the right thing to do is. And the question becomes, how could they get it done effectively? What would they need to say and do? And then what would the pushback or the objections be? We call those the reasons and rationalizations. And then how could you respond to those? What would be effective ways to counter them or to reframe the challenge or to appeal to other players? So basically, that was the core idea. It's based on some of the research that's come out of the work on in social psychology around ethics and behavioral ethics, and the idea that when we encounter a values conflict, we don't necessarily just sit down and make a pro and con list or think what would John Rawls say or, you know, that kind of analytic approach. we tend to react immediately, automatically, emotionally, even unconsciously, and then rationalize post hoc why it was the only thing we could do or even the right thing to do. And so what we're trying to do is to literally rewire that connection so that you've had the experience practicing scripting, acting out, action planning, voicing these issues, so that when you're in those moments, your automatic emotional response, you've also looked at case examples of people who've done this effectively, your automatic response is to realize, you know, there may be some other options available to me. You'll recognize the kind of objection you're encountering. We've identified, you know, some of the most frequently heard kinds of rationalizations and pushback, and we've also begun to unpack ways to address them. So that's kind of the core idea behind it, is the idea of rehearsal and prescripting. It's not traditional adversarial role-playing, because if you actually believe the research around practice and rehearsal, you really don't want half the class to be practicing all the negative pushback. You know, so rather what we do is we ask people to identify that kind of pushback. You don't want to be ignorant or naive about it. But we're all working together to try and enhance our scripts and action plans to make them more likely to be effective. And so we created, hundreds of pieces of material. There's cases, there's exercises, readings, there's books, there's a MOOC through Coursera, there's a bunch of videos, short little videos, there's an interactive set of modules. And much of it is free. The stuff that's published, like the interactive modules or the books, obviously the publishers charge. But we started sharing it and people started using it in many different ways. One of my key motivators was to try and design an approach that would appeal to the non-ethics faculty, not the unethical faculty, but the faculty teaching accounting or finance or marketing, et cetera. And so it was designed primarily to address some of those concerns. So I find those faculty would say to me, look, I'm not a philosopher. Well, this is post-decision making. So it's not asking you to be a philosopher. They would say, my syllabus is crowded. So the action plans and the scripts that the students are developing for these cases actually we're asking them to use the language and the analytics of the discipline you're in, so that you are in fact framing the issue in a way that uses the terminology and the concerns of that particular functional area. They might say, look, I don't want to preach to my students because it's not effective and it leads to bad evaluations. And so, you know, but this is not that, you know, this is what if you were going to do this. That's the key idea here. We never ask people, what would you do? Because we find that if you ask them that, they'll either give you the answer they think you want to hear, or they'll say, well, you know, I know what you want me to say, but it's not possible. Or they'll just argue with the premise and say it's not wrong. And so we just skip over that. It's kind of a pedagogical sleight of hand. Instead, we simply ask, what if you wanted to do this and thought it was the appropriate thing to do? How could you be effective? Once you kind of do that, you unlock all of the resistance that's automatic, where people don't want to say they would do something if they know in their heart they don't think they could be successful. It triggers a kind of cognitive dissonance. And so instead we just ask, what if you were this person who wants to do this? How could this be successful? So now the way the students show they're smart and sophisticated is not by posing as cynical or skeptical, but rather by figuring out a way to do the thing that everyone says is impossible. I'm running short of time, so I'm just going to conclude. There's a lot more to say, but I'm going to conclude by saying that giving voice to values, as you can see, is really basically just a reframe. Instead of asking what's right, we ask, how do you get the right thing done? We've based it on three flips. We flipped what it is you think you're talking about, who we think we're talking to, and how we have the conversation. So in terms of what it is we're talking about, it's not about the gray issues, which is what, you know, I used to think that's really the only place we should focus, because the clear-cut issues are easy. But actually, just because an issue, you know, seems clear cut doesn't mean it's easy to act on it. So we actually focus on issues that appear to be more clear cut, right, wrong, so that you can actually get to action planning. If you focus only on the gray issues, you never get past the conversation about how many angels dance on the head of a pin. You can't stuck in analysis. And what we've also found is that once people start feeling more competent to raise and act on these issues, a lot of the issues they were naming as gray actually become a little more clear cut, because they're kind of framed in our head as gray as part of a way to cope with our feeling of lack of effectiveness. And then we've reframed who we think we're talking to, because we think of our audience as a bell curve. This is based on work by Greg Deese and Peter Crampton. And we premise that one tail end of the bell curve are the folks who might self-identify as opportunists. People who would say, I will always try and maximize my material self-interest regardless of values. Now, nobody falls into one of these categories all the time, but these are people who say that's my primary motivation. And at the other tail end of the bell curve, we premise are the folks who would identify as idealists, who would say, I will always try and act on my values regardless of self-interest. What we premise is the majority of the students fall under the bell. I put myself there, and we call them pragmatists. And we define pragmatists as people who would say, I would like to act on my values as long as I had a reasonable chance of doing so effectively. So the idea is not that I'm sure I'll succeed or not that I know I'll never pay a price, but just, I think I have a shot. And if you think of your audience that way, I don't really think I have the power to change the opportunists. I think they'll always be with us. And I'm not so worried about the idealists, except I'd like them to be more skillful. But we really are focusing on the pragmatists and saying, we want to give you the positive examples, the literal scripts and action plans, the rehearsal, the practice, the peer coaching, to be who you already want to be at your best. We're not trying to change you, we're trying to enable you. And our premise is that if enough of the pragmatists and the idealists got more skillful at this, it changes the water that the opportunists are swimming in. So the calculus they do to determine what's in their self-interest has got to change, because they can't rely on the same level of silent complicity. And then the final flip is how we do all this, and I already explained that. We use the GVB thought experiment. Instead of asking what's right, we ask, how do you get the right thing done? There's a lot more I could say. There's seven pillars and there's many examples, but I'm gonna stop there, because I know the purpose of this session is for us to have a dialogue. So I will stop. And Jennifer, I don't know if you want to MC or how you want to handle the question.
Yeah, I normally, so everyone, if you have questions for Mary, please put them in the chat and I will read them for her. And, but I just want to say, like, this is very, very cool. I come from a behavioral background. I used to train dolphins. So, you know, how do you teach kids like to stop a bully? Well, you have to have them practice the behaviors, because otherwise in the moment, they're going to freeze and not issue the thing you told them that maybe they should say to a bully, right? What is the proper response when someone's bullying you? Well, you have to practice the kids saying it out loud. Otherwise, in the moment, they're not going to say it at all. And that rehearsal, that muscle memory definitely helps when you're talking about doing this in reality when there's a challenge. So the first question we have is from Cynthia. And this is actually one of the questions that came up on the intake form. How do you define value? Values. What are values?
Right. So I mentioned right at the end that we have seven pillars for giving voice to values, and the first one is values. It's a whole chapter in the original book. And what we try to clarify is that when we talk about values and giving voice to values, we're not, you know, values is an overdetermined term, right? And when people do values clarification exercises, they include all kinds of things, you know, may have to do with the people who are value solitude versus the people who value community, or, you know, all of that kind of stuff. What we're talking about here are moral or ethical values. And we're really trying to base it on some of the research that philosophers and psychologists have done. Philosophers call them hypernorms. You know, the values that you know they have determined tend to be, despite cultural differences and all of that, which are real, these are the values that tend to be pretty much universally shared among humans. And the good thing about it is that it allows for common, you know, sort of some sort of common ground. The other thing about it is that it's a really, really short list and it's pretty high level. And it's things like integrity, fairness, compassion, respect, things like that. There's really just five or six that the words vary a little bit, but there's really just a few that people tend to look at. And so what we try and do with GVV is we say, look, the first thing you want to do when you encounter these kinds of values conflicts is to think to yourself, you know, what is the value that is at stake here, you know? And is this something that rises to that level of one of these kind of core values, hyper norms? Or is it really more something that is just my comfort level, my preferred style, you know, that kind of thing? And the idea is that those aren't, it's not that those aren't valid, but you know, we may want to think about if it does rise to the level of one of those core values, then when we talk about it, we want to appeal to the value that we're likely to share. So you want to make sure, this is all about communication, right? And framing. You want to make sure you're talking about it in terms that the other person can resonate with. And so you're going to want to frame it in terms of one of those kinds of shared values. The other reason we approach it this way is that although I think it can be fun and even valuable for people to reflect, you know, do those values clarification exercises, there's tons of them out there, you know, with cards and now there's digital ones, et cetera. It can be useful, but those actually define values much more broadly. As I was saying, they're not just the moral values. You know, I like country, you like city, that kind of thing. But the other thing is that usually those exercises involve eventually narrowing, right? They're usually structured as a kind of pyramid. You start with all these values and then you keep winnowing it down. And when you get to close to the top, you're ending up with motherhood and apple pie. You tend to end up with some of those pretty basic, high level, core, hyper norm type values. And so it's not that that isn't a good exercise, especially with younger students. But what GVV is about is really focusing on those values that tend to be shared as part of why we've been able to work so well globally. And I can share more about that if you're interested.
That was going to be the next question. Like, we had about five different people ask about the cross-cultural nature of values education. So I think a lot of the reason people are hesitant to introduce values into their classroom, whether it's accounting or strategy or whatever, is that they're worried about cultural variations within the values. So if you can speak to, I like this idea of the hyper norms and this there really is a common global ethic that is high level. If you can speak to that to help allay people's fears that, yeah, you can do this, it'll be okay.
Yeah. So yes, absolutely. So the first thing I'll say is one more thing on the hypernorms. This kind of, a lot of it grew out of my work with Tom, you know, reading Tom Dunphy and Tom Donaldson's work around those kinds of shared high level values too, not just the Martin Seligman and people like that. But in terms of the cross-cultural issue, yeah, this was a real concern for me when I was first developing GVV, because I started getting invited to go to China, to go to India, to go to share this in Africa, to share it in Russia, South America, et cetera, and the Middle East. And I was concerned, you know, because I thought, I don't know. And senior, you know, faculty in the US and in Western Europe primarily were saying to me, Mary, you know, this is kind of interesting and it might work here, but it's not going to work in, and then they'd fill in the blank, you know, one of those regions or countries that I was just mentioning. And I thought, well, they could be right, you know? I mean, here I am, Mary Gentile from Boston, right? How do I know? But I started getting invited to go to those places and I learned some things. So it's turned out that there's been a good bit of interest and receptivity around the world. But I learned that I have to do five things when I try and use GVV cross-culturally. And I learned this because I was doing a two-day program on GVV for a group of Indian entrepreneurs and faculty who taught entrepreneurship in India. And I was doing the programs in 2 days in Delhi and 2 days in Bangalore. And the same thing happened in both places. You know, I started out on the morning of the first day, there's like 35 people in the room and they're all kind of sitting there smirking at me, right? Leaning back in their chairs with their arms crossed, kind of like, yeah, right. And so, you know, I said, what is it? You know, and finally some brave soul would say, Madam, we're very delighted you're here. And we're happy to listen to you for 2 days about giving voice to values. But you got to understand, this is India and we're entrepreneurs and we can't even get a driver's license without paying a bribe. So this really isn't going to be relevant to us, but we're delighted to listen. So, you know, that was an interesting start. But I actually learned I had to do these five things and it ended up working really well. So the first thing you have to do is you have to acknowledge the reality of the context, right? You know, some of the places I go The laws are very different, or the enforcement of the laws are very different, or the common practices can be very different. So in that case, I said, look, you know, this is not my first trip to India. I've been here 10 or 12 times. I know what you're saying is often true. I've experienced some of it, you know. So you acknowledge the reality of the context. The second thing you have to do is you have to basically start from a place of respect, which is, you know, I would say, well, look, you know, I know that a lot of what you're saying is true. I also know that you're not always thrilled about the fact that in order to get something done, you have to pay a bribe. I mean, I have many friends in India who would tell me these horror stories about how frustrating it was to be driving to go pick up their kid at school, and they get stopped by a cop who says you're speeding when they're not and wouldn't let them go until they paid the bribe, right? You know, and this is not something they were happy about. And I said, so I know that this isn't necessarily something that you want, you know, it's just part of this reality of your context. So I know you have values. So what I'm here about is not to tell you what your values should be, it's to actually help you be more effective at acting at the on those values. And then the third thing I would do is explain what I just explained to you guys about the giving voice to values thought experiment, that I'm not going to give you a scenario and say, what would you do? I'm going to give you a scenario and say, what if you were this protagonist who wanted to do, who thought the right thing to do was X, how would you get it done effectively? And what that does is a couple of things. First of all, it lowers the stress. But then secondly, we know from the research that people are more creative and more innovative when the stress comes down. So it kind of gives them that space. This is a laboratory. This is a time to think creatively and innovatively. So I'm going to try and come up with things that if you had asked me what I would do, I might not even think of, or if I thought of them, I wouldn't put them forward because I think they sounded naive. But because we're brainstorming here, I'm gonna let myself think more openly. And then the fourth thing is that I always try, if I can, to have an example of someone who did this successfully in that culture. So in this case, in India, I had worked with the Carnegie Council on International Affairs and Ethics. And we developed a series of videos, GVV style videos, with an Indian entrepreneur who had purchased a company from one of the major multinationals, a consumer products firm. And when he purchased it, it was basically near bankruptcy. It was hugely corrupt, and it was in violation of Indian labor laws. And in the space of 2 years, he turned it around to be quite successful financially and also to be seen as a model of clean operating. And so I had these video interviews with him where he would lay out a values conflict, an ethical conflict, often about corruption, but not exclusively. And he'd stop it at the point of, you know, I'm being pressured to do X, I don't want to do X, how can I not? And then we had his interview, how he handled it. And so we shared those with them, and those do a couple things. First of all, it triggers a sense of pride, because this is someone from your culture, someone who is successful, who's doing this effectively. And secondly, it triggers a kind of sense of competition. Well, if he can do it, we can do it. And then the fifth thing that I have to do when I go globally is to try and explain, and I often have to do this actually in the US and the West as well, but to explain that the voice in giving voice to values is a metaphor. So it doesn't mean shaking your fist and telling your boss that he or she is a jerk. You know, it often might mean asking a question. It might mean talking to someone who talks to someone who talks to the decision maker. It might mean reframing the challenge in a way that will allow the decision maker to see it differently. It might mean writing a memo. It might mean working to get someone who you know is very influential and knowledgeable onto the task force that makes the decision. We talk about all these different strategies in GVV. And what that does is it's very helpful, especially in cultures that have a high authority kind of hierarchy kind of challenges. And so it helps people realize there may be some more creative ways to do this. Once we do those five things, it sort of appeals to an appetite in people, because it allows them to think, well, I have some more options here, you know, and because people always say, well, in this culture, it's this or that. But, you know, we hear the same thing from the US students. Well, you can't do that in this company because the boss will say X. So a lot of this is really about helping people realize they have more choices than they thought they did.
Excellent.
And I can give you a lot of other examples if you're interested. We've worked with folks in Egypt to create a set of GVV Egypt cases. We worked in India with the UN to create a set of Indian anti-corruption cases. We've got some China cases. We've worked with folks in Africa.
So I really liked that because it actually goes into the next question and the next question that we have on the chat, which is, you know, the problem people have, you know, it's not so much that the higher values are not the same, it's that the reality of the situation they're in may or may not allow them to give voice to their values. So the question becomes, how do you act on your values when the people around you are not, which is tied to Gerard Ferrais's question is, I'd love to hear stories of how someone successfully gave voice to their values in a real situation.
That the question was to ask, how do you do it or to give a story?
Yes. You know, both of them is, you know, it's tied together, right? How do you actually do this when the people around you are not being ethical and your reality is that you're surrounded by what you perceive to be unethical? And can we have a real life story about that?
Yeah, absolutely. So the first thing I'll say is that is in fact the point of GVB. So that question, you know, how do you do this when people around you are pressuring you to do something else? That is GVB. So that, and we have many, many cases, and most of them try and illustrate people who've done this successfully, although some of them people tried and failed. And then the question is, how could you get it done? Let me just think, I'll share one story with you, but there's many others. And if you're looking for a particular issue, email me and I'll tell you if we've got one on that topic. But the one I'm thinking of is a case called Not an Option Even to Consider. It's a disguised case and we made up a country, but it's a Southeast Asian country. And there is a gentleman who works for a global multinational pharmaceutical firm. And he's been asked to be the country manager for their efforts to open their business in this particular country. And there's a lot of corruption in the country, and they have both an over-the-counter business and they also have a, you know, prescription-only business. And so they can do the over-the-counter business, but they can't get into the prescription business until they get approved by the Ministry of Health. And he just can't get access to these permissions. First of all, he has trouble getting appointments with them, but he can't get this permission, and there's these gatekeepers, and it's clear that he's supposed to pay a bribe. Now, his multinational parent company has policies against this, right? And he's trying to figure out how to do that. And it's taking a while. And even his multinational home country managers are saying, maybe you have to pay this bribe. This is getting ridiculous, right? So, but he doesn't think that's the way he wants to go. At the same time, what they are able to the business they are able to get into is over-the-counter business, selling, you know, things like the equivalent of ibuprofen and stuff like that, or Tylenol or something, but it's their brand. And but then he's having trouble there too, because there are other companies that are getting into that same market, selling these pain relievers, but they're they're knockoffs basically. They're not as effective, right? But they're run by generals who have been given this business as a reward for being loyal to the government. So he's got problems at both ends, right? He can't get the permission to go into the prescription business, and he's being undercut by these lower priced, lower quality over-the-counter drugs that the government has given permission to. So he's trying to figure out how to do this. And so we have the A case where it lays out more detail than what I can say right now. And then the B case of how he handled it successfully. So successfully, in fact, that he then was asked to do the same thing again in other countries. But he talks about how he had this mix of carrots and sticks where he looked at the country. He realized, number one, he didn't have relationships. So he started really spending a lot of time just trying to connect with and build relationships with the government representatives without even asking for anything. He also realized that, and he worked with physicians in the country, locals, who he hired to help him with his business, who were kind of coaching him a little bit. And he was trying to learn their language, and they said, no, we want to practice our English. So they, you know, he was trying to connect with them. And then he started to realize that a big problem in the country was a drug resistance problem. And So he kind of did what he said, carrots and sticks. On the carrot side, he went to the Ministry of Health and was explaining, you have a burgeoning problem here with some drug resistance, antibiotics, drug resistance. There was a big problem with hepatitis B, I believe it was. And he said, we would like to put together a program, you know, to educate the pharmacists in your country, to put together some resources to help people understand what this issue is. So he did this over a period of time, and it built a relationship in a sense that he was trying to communicate to them that our company is here for the long term, that we're invested in your country. We're not trying to just in and out exploit you. And then on the stick side, he worked with some of the other countries that were trying to do business in this region to create some hurdles for this country to get access to global markets if they didn't do certain things in terms of how they were operating. And so he kind of was working both ends of the stick. And then he also, once he developed some relationship with the Ministry of Health, they actually saw how he was helping the country, how they were invested long-term. Then he had some standing to actually go legally after some of the generals who were selling knockoffs. And so it was this incremental process. It was strategic. It ended up being quite successful. And then he ended up replicating it for this company and other places as well. He's a really remarkable guy, but that's one example. And we also have a lot of very narrow examples where, you know, I'm dealing with something where somebody's asking me to do something wrong, you know, and I'm low level in the organization and finding ways to address that. So there's the high level and there's the middle level and there's the low level. And obviously the strategies you use are very different.
So the Giving Voice to Values website has a lot of these case studies that act as, yeah, perfect.
So and most of these materials are for free download. When I moved to Darden, UVA, one of the conditions was I said, I want all the legacy materials to remain free. So even though Darden Business Publishing sells their cases, there's hundreds of material that are still free. And the new cases that we've developed since I've been at Darden, they charge their usual case price for. That's just a handful of the cases at this point.
Perfect. So for people who are looking for these things for your classrooms, I would assume they span the spectrum of business issues, whether it's accounting or whatever. So someone in an accounting class should be able to find a case study that they could then use that's appropriate to their field of study, correct?
Yeah, exactly. We have something called an annotated table of contents that you can download right from the Giving Voice to Values curriculum website at Darden Business Publishing. And I know you're going to post these links. And after each case, it lists, you know, what the kind of issue is and what kind of course it would work well in. Accounting is one of the areas that's used this a lot. We have a Giving Voice to Values book series, and there's even a whole case devoted to using it in accounting. And others have, Steve Mintz has an accounting textbook that's pretty widely used that uses a lot of GVV in it. But there's also, you know, finance, economics type cases. There's operations, supply chain, international business, as I was just describing. There's diversity. There's, you know, a range of things.
Excellent. So the next question is from Robert Full. He says, will you walk us through the logistics of how you conduct a practice session in a classroom?
Yeah, absolutely. So there's a number of different ways to do it. I'll tell you kind of like my sort of platonic version, and then, you know, there's adaptations depending on what works for you. But what I typically would do is have people read the case. And well, first of all, they get introduced to the GVV concept and the methodology, and I would probably run them through a case as a group so they understand how to do this. There's a protocol of four questions that we ask them to work through. And I can share those if you like. And then once they understand that method, we'll actually give them the GVV cases, and we ask them to work. Typically, I ideally want them to work in teams. So they prepare them as an individual, then they come up into a team and share what they prepared individually and try and come up with the team's best, most likely to be successful approach. And then when we come back to the large group, the teams will present their approach and the rest of the class will peer coach them to make it better. And we have a guideline for peer coaching on in the curriculum site, a set of questions to answer. So the idea is that there's not one way to do this. A lot of it will depend on, you know, the relationship with the individual, what the organizational context is. Is this an organization that, you know, has a lot of this practice, or is this somebody who's going rogue? You know, and you're going to approach it very differently depending on that. Is it a an organization, you know, the industry may matter, the financial trajectory, whether the company's doing well or doing poorly, can matter. So we end up having people thinking up as many strategies as possible. The idea here with GVV is not that there is one right way to do this. If you think about it that way, people tend to immediately go to whistleblowing. And GVV is all about not having to whistleblow. I mean, obviously there are times when whistleblowing is necessary. Stakes are high, time is short, lives are stake, whatever. But GVV is really about trying to help people learn how to have these conversations before that becomes a necessity. Because what we know from the research is that when you get to that point, whistleblowing is really costly for the whistleblower, for the company, for whoever the affected stakeholders were. And so we're really trying to ask them to do that. So the teams present their plan, the rest of the group will peer coach and try and enhance their scripts. And that's how we typically use it. Sometimes people will even do it as a written assignment. One university actually used it as an exam question, and it was part of how they were able to demonstrate their assessment of learning around ethics for the AACSB accrediting body, which was quite receptive to what they did. So there's lots of different ways to do it, but my preferred approach is when people reflect on it individually, come up with some their best ideas based on what they've read, and we have, you know, all these materials about tools and ways to unpack the arguments. And all of this is on the website. And then to work in a team, because then you're going to get more ideas, and then to share it with the large group and debrief. And that's where you get, it's not the adversarial role play, it's actually the peer coaching role play.
So his follow-up question is, how much time do you allocate for each of these steps?
Again, it depends on how you do it. If you do it as a written assignment, obviously you don't use it in class, you don't have any time class. Depending on the cases, some of the cases are very short and you could probably just, you know, spend 20 minutes. Once they understand the GVV methodology, which is pretty easy to explain. I mean, you know, I shared it with you in 15 minutes. They go deeper when they read the articles that suggest what are the kinds of arguments you're likely to encounter, how are some ways to begin to respond to it. But once they understand that methodology, you can do a short case in 20 minutes, or you could spend a whole class session on one, like the corruption story I was just telling you, not an option even to consider. So it really depends on that. The other thing I'll say is that there are those faculty who say, look, my syllabus is so crowded that I can't even add anything, you know, on any new case, new material. So with those folks, sometimes I've worked with faculty who say, I already use this case. I use it to teach, you know, these concepts that are important to my discipline, but it does have a potential values conflict in it that we just don't address. And so sometimes people will say, I can't really add new material, but we can craft a kind of GVV discussion pasture so that in addition to teaching the concepts you're teaching with that case, maybe you spend 15 minutes at the end of the class or some point in the class, applying the GV or as a part of your preparation or homework or whatever, applying the GVV methodology to the values issue, which can be important because just the fact of ignoring the values issue sends a strong signal that you may not want to be sending anyways. So again, depending on how much time you have and what course you're teaching and whether this is the topic of the course, you're teaching a values-driven leadership or a leadership or an ethics course, or whether you're teaching accounting and this is just along the side, you can spend more or less time. And people should feel free to email me if they have more specific questions about that.
Great. Bruce Kibler says, I'll be brazen to say that we have lost the ability in the US politics, which represents the values which drive our economic, societal, and even environmental agendas. How do we reintroduce GVV, not just in the classroom, but societally, economically, and even environmentally?
Yeah. I think about that a lot. I think there's some real uses to JVV in those contexts, because a lot of it is about figuring out how to talk to someone about a values-based position in such a way that in order for the other person to hear me, they don't have to, and I'm quoting a psychologist here, they don't have to stand in a place of humiliation in order to hear me. So in other words, you'll see in the JVV cases that typically the person who's trying to act on their values is not accusing the other person of being a jerk. They're trying to reframe the challenge. They're trying to help them see some stakes that they may not have recognized. They're trying to reduce the stakes that the individual might have experienced. There's lots of different ways they do it. I think in terms of our current political and environmental and social kinds of challenges, a lot of those skills are also applicable. I don't think it's an easy transition, partly because there are those JVV cases where the person you're trying to persuade knows that what they're asking you to do is wrong. And you're trying to help them find a way, an off-ramp for that behavior, and something that will help move them to that. In our country right now, well, I'm talking the US, I know there may be folks here from other places, but this challenge is not restricted to the US these days. The kinds of values conflicts that I think you're talking about, a lot of times people actually do think they're right on both sides. It's not that I know that I'm breaking the rules, but I want to do it because of X, Y, and Z. But it's more that they actually have a whole ideological framework that supports where they're standing. And so it makes it more complex. It's not that the skills and tools aren't useful and can't be applied, but it does make it a little more complex. I think some of our GVV cases that deal with diversity and inclusion may start to get to some of that, but it's tricky. I'll give you one example. When I was teaching at Harvard Business School, I designed and taught their first course on managing diversity, and I wanted to have, and this was back in the mid 90s, so the classroom was almost entirely white male. So I'm teaching a diversity class, right? And I had one day that I was going to talk about the concept of affirmative action, which I knew was going to be really hot, was going to be really tricky in that context at that time. And so I decided to discuss it using potholders. So I wrote a case about the FCC, the Federal Communications Commission, which at that time under President Clinton had wanted to come up with a way to make the spectrum rights, radio wave rights, more available to women-owned and minority-owned and even rural or small business-owned organizations. And they could never compete effectively with the larger organizations. And so they came up with this idea of, rather than having quotas or something more traditionally affirmative action, they came up with an auction kind of approach. And so we wrote a case study about this. And it was my idea that we would start talking about ways that you begin to give access to different groups without going directly at affirmative action initially. But the students were onto me, and even at Harvard Business School, where you're graded on how much you talk, and usually you can't shut them up, nobody would talk. And so at a certain point, I just said, well, okay, this didn't work. You guys know what I'm trying to do here. You don't want to talk about affirmative action because you think it's too sensitive. So let's try something different. So I put the case aside and I drew a line down the board, a vertical line. And I said, okay, on this side of the board, I want you all to pretend for a moment that you are vehement opponents of affirmative action. What are the values that are driving you? And they created a list of values, and they were things like meritocracy and fairness and equal opportunity, things most of us wouldn't quibble with. And then I said, okay, now I want you, let's go to the other side of this line. I want you all to pretend for a moment that you are vehement supporters of affirmative action. Just pretend. What are the values that are driving you? And they made a list of values. Well, of course, it's the same list. Everybody thought they were working for fairness. Everybody thought they were working for meritocracy, And so once we got that up on the board, I said, okay, look, I said, this is not easy. We're still gonna have a tricky conversation, but can we establish that the values that we're trying to support or enhance or act on here, that we share a lot of values? it's an implementation problem. We have very different ideas about how to implement this effectively, but can we get to that point? Now, that was before I developed GVB, but I do think that something like that approach might be a way to begin to unpack some of the current, to have the conversation about some of the current issues. But I don't have an easy answer to that one.
I think if there was an easy answer, we wouldn't be in the situation we're in.
I recently wrote a very short op-ed. I don't know if you remember the piece. I guess it was Isaiah Berlin, and it was based on some Greek philosopher or something who talks about the hedgehog and the fox. You guys know that story where the fox knows many small things and the hedgehog knows one big thing. And when I was in college, it was sort of this intellectual game that, you know, my friends and I would play over, you know, drinking at the end of the day, you know, who's a hedgehog, who's a fox. And in a postmodern world, you know, we all thought it was cool to be a fox and it was kind of stupid to be a hedgehog. Although I realized in retrospect that I really am a hedgehog, but what I wrote about in this little op-ed is that, you know, there's a danger with either side, right? The hedgehogs who don't value the foxes run the risk of being ideologues, and the foxes who don't value the hedgehogs run the risk of nihilism, and that we really need to figure out how to bring those together. And I think that's part of what we're dealing with now. It certainly applies to climate change, for example.
So changing topics, Bill Prinzivalli says, what does a typical session look like at an organization? E.g., does it require multiple consulting meetings to understand the issues and define the ultimate scripts?
It's a great question. So again, it varies depending on what the organization wants and can do. But it's been a learning experience for me because I never intended this to be for organizations and companies, and I've never marketed it to companies, but companies have found it and like it and have come to me. So I've learned some things like I remember doing a project with Unilever in Nigeria, and they said to me, you know, Mary, what we love about you is that you're not a consulting firm. You're an individual. You're not trying to build a consulting firm. You're a faculty member. And so you're not sort of creating this huge, hugely expensive, hugely complex, hugely long-term kind of thing. And what we hate about you is that you're not doing any of those things. So in other words, I want them to own it, right? And so that makes it, you know, easier and also more complicated. But so we do it very differently. So with Unilever, for example, and with some of the companies I've worked with, I worked with them to, you know, do the reconnaissance to identify what some of the relevant issues were, for example, with Unilever in Nigeria, and then to create custom kinds of GVB style scenarios. So examples of post-decision-making cases, hopefully drawn from real examples where people found a way to handle them, teach them the GVB methodology, and then have them practice with them. I will typically try and do something, because I am just an individual and I don't want to create a consulting firm, I'll typically try and do some sort of train the trainer kind of thing, which is what I did in Nigeria. I worked with a group of about 35 high potentials to teach them the methodology, to train them, and then to train them how to train others. And then they disseminated it throughout the organization in small groups. We've developed these interactive online modules through a company called Nomadic, and we actually customized them for Nigeria. We used some Nigerian scenarios. We changed the look. We featured, you know, their CEO, that kind of thing. And so we had them all do those before they did the in-person. So the idea is that then they only needed a much shorter amount of time in person to be introduced to the approach. I worked with Prudential, where I actually trained a group of their internal trainers to design and deliver a GVB thing. But then they had me come in and sort of socialize the idea with the senior executives so that they would then say, oh yeah, that sounds interesting, and then ask their internally trained people to deliver it. So I was sort of building the appetite for it. I worked with McKinsey. They do their own leadership development training, and they use their own senior partners as faculty, because of course, who's smarter than them in their minds. And so I say that with love, but so I went and to a program where they were, where I introduced GVB to the 70 or 80 senior partners who served as leadership faculty for the firm. And then led them through some GVB scenarios and then helped them design some exercises, but then they delivered them. Some smaller companies have actually had me come in and do a training, but I prefer not to do that so much because of the time commitment. I've also worked with organizations to customize the materials we have. So we've customized the interactive modules for the CFA Institute, the Chartered Financial Analyst Institute. So they now make those available to their membership all over the world. We've also worked with the Australian Institute of Health and Safety to customize our Coursera GVB MOOC for the health and safety professionals in Australia. So, and we're working with the Government Financial Officers Association in the US to customize the interactive module. So we do lots of different things. And sometimes companies just have me come in and give a talk. And then they think about how they're going to try and use it. There's other examples, but Lockheed Martin is a company that's used it the most, for the longest amount of time. And they actually already had a program where they developed videos every year with scenarios, but it was much more, here's the scenario, you know, what's the right thing to do? And for the last 8 or 10 years, they've shifted them to be GVB scenarios where it's about how could you act on the right thing to do. And so can I
kind of interrupt and ask a follow-up question to all of that? Because it's fascinating.
I could go on for a while, sorry.
No, that's okay. So in my mind, because a lot of my work is with companies, you know, I'm a corporate trainer. So the question I have is, has this methodology kind of, it seems like this methodology would be a really great way to, as a just a regular conversation for teams to help figure out strategy and development, to use this methodology in just the regular course of business? And have you seen that happen after having done these train the trainer and high level?
So that's my, you know, holy grail, devoutly to be wished kind of objective. I'm not there. So I mean, that's what I encourage them to do. But I'm not there every day, all the time for every organization. So I can't promise that's what they're doing, but I do hear stories of people who, you know, have enacted. So for example, I was telling you about Unilever, the woman who was my handler while I was there in my trip, my first trip to Lagos, you know, she was with me all week as I was meeting with people. And I had an hour before I went to the airport on the last day. And she said, "Do you have time to talk to me?" And I said, "Sure." So she shared two examples she was currently facing. One was around sexual harassment. One was around an environmental issue. And we just spent an hour, you know, coaching and scripting and action planning. And the next time I went back to Lagos and was doing a training, she shared with the group that she had actually successfully implemented what we had talked about on the environmental issue. So I know some of that happens. I also know, for example, similarly, that training, we brought the senior management together with the middle managers, and they engaged in creating what they called the GVB contract, which was, you know, we had a discussion about how can you bring an issue to a senior leader that makes it easier for the senior leader to hear it. We asked the senior leaders to generate those answers. And so they ended up making this contract about what would make it easier for me to raise it as a middle manager, what would make it easier for me to hear it as a senior leader. And they made a commitment to each other in a town meeting kind of thing. So some of that happens, but I can't report on every organization because I'm not there. That's my goal though.
Right. The holy grail for, I think, every consultant, right?
Right.
So I want to thank you for your time. We are out of time, and I feel bad because there was one more question. Teresa had a question, but maybe we
feel free to email me, Teresa.
But I want to thank you for your time and coming. Again, this was Teaching Teachers to Teach Values from the International Humanist Management Association. The video and resources will be on our website. So thank you very much.
Thank you, everybody. It was great to hear from you.